Hey guys, Jfarr here. In just one click, we'll set up a dedicated Rust server, and I'll show you how, the quick and in-depth way. A dedicated server will give you the freedom to test out features, practice your aim, record a video, or play with a few mates. So let's get started. Let's break starting a server down into 5 key steps. The install, creating batch files, startup, server permissions, and optionally, port forwarding if you want to play with a few mates. However, with the file linked in the description I created, we can skip the first 3 steps. Now extract the downloaded file and move the batch file into the folder in which you'll want to install the server. I would recommend doing this all on an SSD. In my experience, server startup on a hard drive will take around 5 to 10 minutes, while on an SSD will take around 2 minutes. Let's look at what the batch file will be doing. First, it will request to download the Steam CMD files from Valve's developer page and extract those files. It will then launch the Steam CMD EXE and input the commands to install the Rust server files. Once that's complete, we'll generate an additional batch file to be stored within our Rust server folder. This will allow us to customize the server if we desire. Otherwise, we can double-click the batch file to start up the server for us to connect to. Now, open Rust and type connect localhost, followed by 28015, which is the default Rust server port I set in the batch file. If you only wanted to host your own server without others connecting, you're essentially done. Skip over to the permissions section of this video to learn how to give yourself admin. Continue watching and we'll go step by step through the process, essentially repeating what the batch file I created did, but manually. We'll first need to install a Steam CMD, which will allow us to install the server files for Rust. Start off by making a file to store everything related to the Rust server files and Steam CMD. I'll call it Rust in-depth install. Now head over to Valve's official Steam CMD developer page. A link will be included in the description. Download the zipped file for Windows into the custom folder we made. The page also contains additional information for installing on a Linux or Mac OS based system. Extract the file and run the Steam CMD.exe. It should now begin to download and extract multiple packages into the Steam CMD file. You can type quit once prompted to do so. Now we have set up the interface to install the Rust server packages. Head inside our Rust in-depth install folder and create a new folder called Rust server. This is where all the Rust server related files will be stored. Now we are ready to start installing the Rust server files. Go into the description to download the setup folder. This will make it fast and easy to follow along. After extracting, open the folder to see 2 sections for server startup and launching server. Before we begin, let's understand a bit about batch files so we know what's going on. Think of batch files as automating the server startup and update process, as they contain a series of commands that will automatically execute in order. Personally, I use 2 batch files, one to launch the server and another one to update it. However, it's up to you as you may want to check for updates every time you open your server. To create a batch file, we'll need to create an empty text file. Make sure you have show file name extensions on, and then rename the file to include .bat at the end. Open it with either Windows Notepad or Notepad++. Inside, include any commands that you want and save it. You have now created a batch file. Now, open back up the folder I have provided and enter the first section to find the server setup batch. Copy this over to our Steam CMD folder. Open it with your text editor to see the commands. Remember, after each plus is a command we would have had to add manually. However, since it's now a batch file, it will do it for us the second we run it. You will need to first modify these fields to include the directory where we'll be installing the Rust server files. We can obtain the path by going into our newly created Rust server folder and clicking on the directory bar at the top. Copy this text and paste it into the batch file, surrounded with a double quotation mark at the start and end of the path. If your path contains spaces and the quotation marks are not used, it will only look at the first part and ignore the rest. As for the app update command, the number at the end corresponds to the app ID for the Rust dedicated server. If you were to be installing for another game, you would include a different number. save, close, and execute the batch file. It will automatically run each of those commands without us having to do it line by line. Now we have the server files, we'll want to create another batch file to update and launch the server. You can find the already made batch file within the files you downloaded from the description. Drag this into the Rust server folder and open it with your text editor. Here we can see two sections, updating the server and launching the server. The first section is exactly the same commands as the one we originally ran to acquire the Rust servers. However, this batch file now does both the update and launching in a single file. If you'd like to not check for updates every time you open the server, you can remove this top part and use the original update batch file within the Steam CMD folder. Within our launch batch file, we'll need to specify the directory to the Rust server folder and Steam CMD exe. Now, you can also update your server to run either the staging or pre-release branch to get the early updates, by entering this command at the end of app update. Here you can also see I've included the versions in the commented line, so you can easily swap them out. You can comment a line out by using two colons. This will ensure the line of instructions will be ignored during the execution of the batch file, and is only there for you to see. The second section will be for launching our server. Since we are creating the batch file within our Rust server folder, we don't need to specify the path for the rustdedicated.exe, like the Steam CMD above, as it's in the same folder as the batch file. Now, here is where we get to customize our server. Starting off, you can configure map types such as procedural, barren, hapus, and savas. If you decide to go public, set max players to whatever you believe your system or server can handle. The default map size is 4,250, however you can decrease or increase to your liking. It looks like the max map size is 6,000. The seed will determine the overall map generation. Keep changing this value until you find something you like. Next is the server identity, which is the folder name that holds all the server data files. Whatever you call this, do not include spaces to avoid issues reading the directory. The server hostname is the text displayed in the server browser. If you plan to make the server public, call it something catchy and descriptive. The server description will be the text displayed after clicking on the server within the browser. Next, the server URL can link to your custom web page. Players can click on this when within the server browser. The header image is a link to an image hosted on a website, such as your own, Imgur, or Wikipedia for some examples. Next, we have the server port and archon port. These two values are similar but quite different. The server port is the port you use to port forward, so other players can connect, based on the UDP protocol. By default, you can leave this port set to 28015. Archon is a TCP communication protocol, allowing Rust admin tools to hook in and use. The value we provide will be the port number to communicate with this admin tool. By default, you can leave this port set to 28016. This is completely optional as you might not decide to use this tool. The Archon password is the one you'll need to type in on the admin tool. Next is the Archon Web 1, which enables the use of WebSocket connection protocol. I'd recommend keeping this to 1. Our final command is go to start. This will instruct the file to return to the start label when the server is shut down. Only include this if you plan on always having your server up and running, otherwise every time you go to close it, it will attempt to restart. There are millions of other commands you can include within the batch file if you plan to get serious. These will be linked in the description. Save the batch file and run it like an exe within your explorer. Your server will now begin to start up. Now, every time you want to start up your server to play on, run this batch file and wait for it to finish. Once finished, you can now head into Rust and open your console by pressing F1. You can now type connect localhost, followed by your UDP port number, specified within the batch file. However, you won't have any admin permissions. Once the server is up, we'll want to assign owner privileges to ourselves so we can legally cheat. You'll need to first obtain your Steam ID 64 number. This can be done by searching for a Steam ID finder tool and linking your Steam profile page URL. Now, within your running server console, include the owner ID command, followed by your Steam ID, and a custom name within double quotes. If you plan to have moderators, you can replace owner ID with moderator ID. You can also remove moderators or owners using the ID or name. Now proceed to type server.writecfg to ensure the settings you just typed are saved into local storage. If you or another player was already within the server at the time of assigning permissions, they'll need a relog to see the effects. If you'd like other players to connect, you'll need a port forward. This can be a little tricky as everyone has a different setup including router and firewall permissions. However, hopefully the process and fixes I demonstrate will be successful for you. The first thing we'll need to understand is how many devices there are between you and the internet. My PC is connected to a router in my room. From there, the router is connected to the primary modem in the house, which is connected to the internet line coming from the wall. To successfully port forward, we'll need to apply these rules to each device in the chain between the PC and the internet, such as the router and modem. Don't do one and it won't flow through the other. Additionally, the modem will need the IP address of the router, and the router will need the PC's IP address during the port forwarding. If you have a direct connection between the PC and modem, this process will be easier. Start by opening your command prompt and typing ipconfig. Locate your default gateway and copy the numbers to paste into your browser. This will take you to your router's admin page. You possibly need to log in with your credentials. By default, this is typically admin for username and password for password. Once inside, head to the advanced settings and locate the port forwarding. It may be under a different category called gaming, WAN services, firewall, or NAT forwarding. We'll now need to add a new entry. Give it a custom name called Rust Server for our first one. For the IP address, this will either depend on how many devices are in between you and the modem. For me, I'm connecting to my router's admin page, so I'll need to link my PC's IPv4 address. Open your command prompt and copy your IPv4 address to paste it in. The external and internal ports will be the server port you specify within the batch file, so by default it will be 28015. If you'd like your server to work with the Archon admin tool, you'll need to do the same thing and inside put the Archon port within the external and internal fields, which is typically 28016. Also, add another entry for the app port if you want to use the Rust Plus app features, with the default port being 28083. If you only had a straight connection to your modem, that's it. However, if you're like me, I now need to connect to my modem's admin page and perform the port forwarding again. This time, I need to link the router's IPv4 instead of my PC's. I can find this by going to all the linked devices and finding my router. Copy the IP and use this. This should now be it for port forwarding. For your friends to connect or for you to test if it's working, you'll now need to obtain your public IP address. Simply just Google my IP and there are multiple sites and services that show you. You can attempt to go into Rust and type connect followed by your public IP to connect. However, it's typically never that easy for some. If this didn't work, we'll need to add a rule to allow connections through our firewall. Search for and open up the Windows Defender firewall and proceed to the advanced settings. From here, head into the inbound rules, since we want to allow incoming connections of others wanting to connect. Add a new rule and select port. Now we want this to apply to UDP, along with the specific local port of 28015. Select allow all connections, followed by giving it a custom name. You might also want to create additional inbound rules for the Archon and app ports. That should now be it. Head back into Rust and attempt to connect again. If it was unsuccessful, then unfortunately something possibly went wrong with the port forwarding rules. Rewind back to follow along again in case you missed a step, or attempt to watch a different video dedicated to port forwarding, as they might have different advice that might better fit your circumstances. The first step to installing plugins is heading over to the UMod Rust page, which I have linked in the description. Press download and you should get a zipped oxide Rust file. Open the zip and drag the Rust dedicated data folder into where we installed the Rust server files, and proceed to press yes if you get any prompts about overwriting the existing folder. We'll now want to start up the server so additional folders can be created, such as an oxide folder. it's time to download a plugin. Head back to the UMod page and click Plugins. You can filter your search, but I have already found one I wanted to install. On the mods page, you can read about its commands and documentation, or just download the file. Drag the downloaded CS file into your Oxide plugins folder. Restart your server if you had it running, or type oxide.reload** to reload all plugins. You can now also go to the Oxide config folder to see a .json file relating to your plugin. Open this up and you can now modify the specific settings for that plugin. Head in game and the mod should all be working as expected. First, find a custom map you would like to download. There are multiple sites that offer free or paid maps. Download the file and extract it. You should now have access to a .map file, along with some additional documentation. Some maps might require plugins to fully function, so remember to check its documentation before proceeding. Now, when players connect to your server, they'll need a way to download the map files. Edit your launch server bat file. You'll need to comment out the server seed and map size parameters. Include a new parameter for server.levelURL, followed by a custom link. This link is where we'll need to host the .map file. We can provide a local path directory so we can play on that map. However, other players won't be able to connect because they can't download the files. Head over to Dropbox and upload your .map file. Once complete, copy the link and paste it within your address bar. Now we need to convert this to a direct download link. We can do this by changing the DL equals 0 to DL equals 1 at the end of the URL. When you go to the link, it should automatically attempt to download the file. Include this URL within your launch server bat file, and you should now be done. Start up your server and connect to see if you have a new custom map. As for the admin commands, I'll provide a link to a list of all the possible commands. By typing noclip, we can fly around and clip through the world. You can speed up by holding shift, slow down with control, or by increasing the noclip fly speed by typing either player.noclipspeed, noclipspeedfast, or noclipspeedslow, followed by value. God will allow you to be invincible, taking no damage. This doesn't continue to apply when you log off. Debug camera allows us to enter a cinematic mode, where we can zoom in, apply cam lerp for smoother camera motion, depth of field, and use arrow keys for looking around. Next, we can type record followed by a custom name. This will start a world recording. After stopping it, we can go to the main menu's recording list and refresh to see our recent recordings. Launch it and we'll enter the world as it was. We can now noclip around, slow down time, or use debug camera to record cinematic pre-recorded events. If you'd like to test shooting players, you can spawn in a fresh spawn by typing spawn player. Or, for scientists, you can type spawn scientist to see the list of options. Spawning items is done through the dedicated items tab, where we can spawn 1, 100, or 1000 items. For vehicles, we can type spawn preceded by the vehicle's name, such as minicopter. To change the time of day, we can type env.time, followed by a value in 24-hour time. To pause time, we can type env progress time, followed by false. Finally, if you'd like to destroy a world object, you can type ent kill. Every command can be bound to a specific key. Type bind, followed by the key, and then the action. Head over to Rust Wiki's keybind page to learn how to fully utilize the bind. Hopefully this video has covered everything you need in order to run and play on a dedicated hosted Rust server. Now get out there and practice your aim, without the worry of others watching as well as testing new features added to the game. Thanks guys for watching and I hope to see you in the next one.